Hello and welcome back. Candy's joined us. Say good evening, Candy.
Hi.
She can't leave us alone. That's what it is. Yeah, I love you too.
I'm sending that into the universe and it's just
hitting. Yeah, it's just come out. We're just talking now about the NLP. And Tracy's worried that she's blinding you with science at home. But I think you're going to get the gist of it as we carry on with the interview. So, Tracy, is there anyone that your technique wouldn't work for?
So, what I was saying, so Candy's putting her hand up there. Look, Candy, give it a go. It might work for you. firstly, I would say it's not an alternative to any professional medical help that you need. I'll just kind of put that out there. It's not an alternative to that. It will only work on somebody who wants to be helped.
Yeah.
So it's all about the rapport that you have with your unconscious and your conscious mind. And I can only facilitate what happens there. So I can't tell somebody this is what you need to do and then your life will be perfect. What I can do is help them to find their own solutions, their own conclusions, their own learnings of what's happened to them and is happening to them. I can only help them to do that by guiding them to it. Actually, the client does all of the work. So if you're not willing to take responsibility for your own transformation and you don't want to really make a change, you just want to kind of...
This is the thing. Some people don't want to make a change. Some people are actually scared of it.
Yeah.
You know, when you talk to people that have had one disaster relationship after the other, you know, trying to say to them, well, actually, you're choosing the wrong type.
Yeah.
You know, and it comes to a point where you have to... identify that you're going to repeat those patterns you do something about it.
Yeah.
You know, and be aware of, you know, who you are and what you want. So for me to meet someone like you is perfect, because you can speak to these people, they can acknowledge whether they want to change, and you can help them. So let's carry on. So how would it work? Say I came to you, what would you do for me?
So I just wanted to actually pick up on something you just said there in terms of when somebody doesn't want to be helped.
Yes.
So, I mean, it wouldn't work on anyone that doesn't want to be helped, but there are secondary gains to everything. So if somebody is in one failed relationship after another, there will be, albeit they may not be aware of it, secondary gains to that, and it could be the sympathy they get from their family and friends because it's another failed relationship, or it could be any number
anything,
of things, but they're quite often unconsciously we don't realize that actually we don't want to do without those secondary gains, we don't want to do without the sympathy, so therefore we tell ourselves, therefore I won't change.
It's because learned behavior, though, isn't it?
They're used
to being in that situation and doing those things.
Exactly. So I've forgotten what you asked me now.
Sorry, what did I ask her, George? What did I ask her, Candy? Candy's not listening anymore.
If you were helping me, what would you
do? What would you do?
Okay,
Thank you.
Well done. I love coming in.
So if you were coming to see me, then I would work with you through the different stages that I was talking about earlier. So it's difficult to kind of say we'd do this because it's tailored to everybody. So it's kind of a three-stage process that I use, but actually it's tailored to the client because you never know what they're going to come in and tell you. So but initially you would start with asking, okay, well, so what is the problem, why are you here, what can I help you with, and how would you like that problem to be, or how would you like that how would you like your perfect world to be, almost, you know, so in regards to a problem situation. I would then start to kind of explore what's behind that. So I'd start to look at, okay, well, so what is it that you believe about yourself that causes you to believe this is a problem for you, or you know, it's difficult to talk about.
It's not always about how they think about themselves, though, is it?
No, so the other one is about the world.
People, yeah.
Yeah, so what do you believe about the world that causes you to believe, you know, whatever it is? So Yeah, so you're just trying to raise awareness, get them back to the point of being at cause so that they're empowered. So when I mean that, you can either be a victim or you can be a cause. If you're a victim, you're never going to help yourself. You're just completely disempowered and you're waiting for the world around you to do something to help you. But if you get the client back to being at cause, then they're in control because they have choices they can make. Mm. They can do something. They're empowered. They can take control, of their thinking.
Their lives and everything, isn't
yeah.
it? Okay, right, we're going to play another song, which is Stevie Wonder and Celine Dion, Overjoyed. I love that version. Anyway, welcome back. So, back to you, my lovely. So, Can you give me some examples of where you have helped people? Because I'm sure you've helped loads of people by just by looking at you and listening to what you do. I bet you're amazing at it as well.
Oh, bless you. Yeah, so I've got, you know, I've had a few clients have come to me. So one lady came to me who was a very high flyer, very successful in business. You had achieved loads and loads and loads and was had got very kind of robotic with it. Was all about the doing. So, you know, doing this, achieving that. And we were saying earlier, weren't we, about the fact that she'd got so, not about her, but the fact that she'd got it so much into the doing and being kind of robotic and successful.
But not actually living.
She'd forgotten how to connect.
Yeah.
She'd forgotten how to connect with her loved ones. So she was desperately unhappy because she'd lost that kind of connection. So that's one example. Another one, a lady was very frustrated and angry about with life, basically. So she, again, another quite a high achiever. She'd got qualification after qualification and then just kind of expected that life should give her some kind of just reward because she'd worked so hard. And it didn't seem to her to be forthcoming, and so she just got more and more frustrated and angry.
Yeah.
And through doing that, she was pushing away exactly what she was really looking for, because the reward she was looking for was to have a sense of belonging, to have meaning in her life, to be loved and have a sense of purpose. But she was pushing away all the people that could give her that with her anger and her frustration, where she was almost like she was saying, I've done all this and I've worked really hard all these years, so where's my reward? And actually her reward was there,
staring in the face,
and she just didn't realise. And then I had this amazing lady come to me recently, and she was suffering from various different kind of fear-based issues, but it manifested for her in not being able to go into a lift, and she'd not been in the lift for 27 years. And at the end of our session, we went up and down in a lift twice.
Aww.
And she was amazing. It was, you know, it was brilliant. It was a brilliant experience for me to see her do that, but it was just amazing. She was elated. So that was, you know, that was wonderful.
And how long do you work with people? I know obviously it's dependent on,
on
how far they want to go.
Yeah.
But generally, so
I've just kind of launched a way of doing it over a 6-week period. So what I used to do and the way I was trained was really to do it so it's called a transformational breakthrough. And you do most breakthroughs take on average about 8 hours. So I was trained to do that all in one day. So you'd literally go through all those three vague areas that I was talking about. You'd go through all of that right from beginning to end in one day. Now that's it's very intensive,
yeah,
and it's very tiring. So you can do it that way. So I've also seen clients where I've split it into 2 days. So we've perhaps done one morning and then the following morning. But I've now just started to do it over a 6 weeks period. So instead you'd come to me for 2 hours to 1.5 hours every week for six weeks. We'll do it in that way, because I just kind of found that actually it's so intense to do it over one day or over 2 days. It's also quite a long period of time for someone to take out of their life to kind of, you know, I mean, you could argue, well, I'll come and see you for a day and then I'll feel better, and so that's worth it. But actually, I think there's benefit in going through the process over a number of weeks, because then it gives your mind and you time to kind of get used to the ideas that you've discovered and the insights you've got, and start putting things into practice.
It must be quite profound for people when they're going through that.
Yeah.
To always had held one belief, and then all of a sudden, it's like taking glasses off and you're seeing life in a completely different way, aren't you?
Absolutely. And the other thing is that, you know, some people have had this belief for years and years and years.
Yeah.
And it takes a long time to rebuild a new habit. So there's some research that's out there, and I don't know the scientists, so I can't kind of quote them, but there is some research out there that says that from a kind of neurological pathway point of view, you have to keep redoing the same thing for 40 days. Now, 40 days might not sound like a long time, but when you've been doing something for like 40 years, say, for example, then it is.
Yeah, wow.
But you need to keep doing it for 40 days before